Namaste and welcome back. In this video, I will be presenting the blockchain foundations. Blockchain has evolved as a promising technology for providing security and trust in many of the applications. That is the reason it has been received significant attention in the academia and research from past one decade. Like any new technology, blockchain has also having a strong foundation which was drawn from three different pillars, or we can say there exists three strong pillars for the blockchain to sustain. And after listening to this particular lecture, you may also agree with me that blockchain is not a completely new technology. However, it has drawn the best possible methods from existing things that you might have already studied at your undergraduate level, and those best possible methods have been tailor-made so that it has evolved as a new technology. That is what the blockchain is. So now we'll start with the discussion on the foundations of the blockchain. As I told you previously, there exist three foundations for this particular blockchain. That will start these foundations. And the three foundations of the blockchain are, first one is networking concepts. In this networking, we are going to see how the blockchain is networked, or blockchain applications are networked. In order to know the networking of the blockchain application, first of all, one must know the concept of the centralized networks, how the decentralized networks will work, then distributed networks and peer-to-peer networks. Because a blockchain network is a decentralized network, and the nodes in the blockchain applications are peer-to-peer, and the agreement between these nodes or peers will be achieved via distributed agreement. So that is the reason we must know the difference between what is meant by centralized, decentralized networks, distributed networks, and peer-to-peer networks. Then afterwards, we'll go to the next foundation called cryptography, because the blockchain is have received significant attention. The reason is it is providing security and trust. This security and trust is already you might have studied at your graduate level. This is provided by using cryptography in the computer field. So this cryptography consisting of the encryption, decryption, hashing, and digital signatures, which is especially for protecting the properties of the assuring the properties such as confidentiality, integrity, authentication, and non-repudiation. So these four properties, how a blockchain will achieve with the help of the encryption, decryption, hashing, and digital signature, that we are going to see in the cryptography part. Next one is data structure. Obviously, whatever the data that you are going to transmit or transact via the blockchain application has to store somewhere or other. So that is the reason where this particular data will be stored, how this particular data is structured. So that is the reason the another foundation is data structure. In this data structure, first of all, we are going to see the chaining system of the blockchain, in which we are going to recall our old friend, which is called linked list, that you might have studied after the basic or fundamental data structures called stacks and queues. Then we have studied linked list. See, the blockchain, general blockchain structure is similar to the linked list concept. But however, they have some differences that we'll see in the concept of data structures. Next one is Merkle tree. Merkle tree is a specialized tree that is built with the help of the cryptographic hashes. Then we'll move on to the distributed ledger technology. Then we'll see how the blockchain is different from the regular databases. Consider the following tree diagrams. In that first diagram represents the centralized network structure. The second diagram represents the decentralized network structure. And third one is distributed network. In the centralized network, there will be a central entity, which is called server. And remaining other dots, which was represented here, are the nodes. These nodes may be mobile phones or laptops or any other computer devices. So basically, this centralized network supports or looks like a client server architecture. That means all the clients will request any service to the server. In turn, server will provide the service. So the communication established between these devices, that is a client device and a server device, is via some communication link. This communication link may be a wired communication or wireless communication. The main advantage of the centralized network is here. So single point is there that is responsible for giving any response or giving any service to all other nodes. In the same way, if this particular central server or server fails, then these nodes have no use and they cannot do any operation because the central server has failed. The reason is the independent nodes don't have any computing facility or computing power. Everything or any computation or any processing, they have to depend upon the central server. The main advantage is since the server is readily available, and the nodes will directly go and request for the computation or resources, then the server will provide. But the main problem is if too many devices are attached to the server, sometimes the server may not process the requests sent by the clients. The main reason is server have a limited capacity. It can hold up to the capacity of holding the request. After that, if they receive any request, then the request may be dropped. That means too many requests from the nodes or too many clients that are attached to the server, then it may create a bottleneck and may lead to denial of service by the server. And on the other hand, since only one server is there, the creation and maintenance of the users' accounts and providing security is also very easy. So in this way, the centralized network have its own advantages and disadvantages. So basically, because of the growing number of clients across the world, the centralized system is nowhere suitable, and this is okay for very limited set of configurations, like a simple server with some 8 or 10 nodes. So till the time scale, this client server architecture will work fine. But thereafter, what will happen is because of the many clients and many requests, the sometimes server may not process due to the bottlenecks of the client requests. So you might have seen, if you might have purchased any Jio Wi-Fi, then they will give you a limit that it can support up to 8 devices or 5 devices, 6 devices, like that. That means all these devices are directly connected to the particular Wi-Fi provider or internet provider. Then that means all these mobile phones will act as client, and they will directly request the Wi-Fi provider or internet provider for the service. So that reason, the provider has a limited capability. That means it can hold up to 5 devices or 8 devices, like that. In the configuration itself, they will mention. So by and large, the centralized system is not a suitable system for holding the many number of clients. As a blockchain, when a blockchain applications are developed and deployed on the large scale, are deployed for the supply chain management, then you can think of in supply chain management, there will be huge number of users. Many users will be there, and they used to communicate with each other. or with the server. So in this way, the scale of the request posed by the clients is huge. So that is the reason in this context, especially for the blockchain context, centralized servers are not that much suitable. So that is the reason, even though the centralized servers have its own advantages and some limitations, they might have been used in the early stages, but now this is nowhere useful for our blockchain technology. Next, we'll move on to the decentralized approach. The main disadvantage of centralized approach is if the server crashes or if the central server fails, then the nodes will not receive any service. In the same way here, to overcome that, we have moved on to the decentralized approach. In the decentralized approach, instead of having a single server, there will be multiple servers. So here, some set of nodes were attached to the multiple servers, or some set of nodes are linked up with the with a server. In turn, this server is having communication with other servers. Like that, this server is having communication with this server. Like this, internally these servers are linked, and nodes will be connected to the nearest server. So it is just like in a university, the department faculty may coordinate with the head of the department. The head of the department may coordinate with the dean, and with the dean, many other head of the departments may also combine, may also contact. And a dean may also come contact with the vice chancellor or any other higher position. So this is the way how the decentralized approach will take in place. So in the main advantage of decentralized approach is there will not be burden on the server like in centralized approach. That means in centralized approach, if too many requests occur, then it may create a bottleneck and may lead to denial of service by the server. The same way, that is the reason by decentralizing the power or the processing and storage capability or processing and service capability, service request, then they can serve more number of nodes, and whatever the nearest node is there, that may communicate with the nearest server and get the work to be done. So this is the basic idea of the decentralized approach. So to summarize, in the decentralized approach, the decentralized network pattern is less likely to fail as compared to the centralized system. Sometimes, because of the decentralization, it may give you the better performance, and sometimes it may allow you to create more flexible systems and diverse systems. On the other hand, since the servers are decentralized and computation capability and other things are decentralized, obviously the security risk also increases, and security and privacy risks also increases. So more security and privacy issues need to be considered as many servers are working in the decentralized system. At the same time, since many servers are available and all the servers are working in the decentralized fashion, obviously it may lead to higher maintenance cost. And sometimes because of the circumstances and because of the local things, many users may connect it to one single server. Instead of at a particular time, remaining other servers may be free. So in such a way, we may get the inconsistent performance. So because a particular server may be occupied by some thousands of users, and some other servers may be having very less load. So in such a cases, obviously overall performance of the decentralized network may be inconsistent. So that reason, better optimization is required to have good performance in the decentralized applications. The most important concept for the coordination among the nodes in any network is clock. In case of centralized network, the clock will be maintained by the central server. So whatever the time available or whatever the timestamp that a central server can create, the same timestamp will be followed by all other client nodes. Where in case of a decentralized approach, the each and every server may have different clocks. So synchronizing all these clocks is a difficult task. So like a centralized system, there is no global clock in the decentralized approach. So the reason clock synchronization and the timestamp maintenance is a big issue in case of a decentralized approach. One of the example of the decentralized approach is peer-to-peer applications or master-slave architecture. So the master-slave architecture or the peer-to-peer architecture is also a kind of decentralized architecture. So far we have seen the concept of the centralized approach and decentralized approach. Now we will see a distributed approach. This is a completely different approach compared to the previous two. In the distributed approach, all the networks will act as autonomous. That means they have sufficient computation powers, but all these networks, all these nodes are connected with each other via some communication links, either it may be wired or wireless. So that is the reason in case of decentralized approach or centralized approach, if the central server fails or a corresponding server fails, then these nodes cannot communicate with any other. But in case of distributed approach, a high fault tolerant system can be built or network can be built using distributed approach. The reason is here, even though any link was failed, this node can get a service from any other node in the network. That means it will follow complete mesh topology, so that failure of one communication link may not stop the entire network, but that particular corresponding node can get the service from any other nearest possible route to have the corresponding service. So distributed network or distributed networking system is a highly fault tolerant system. Like in the decentralized approach, this distributed computing, distributed network is also lagging the global clock. And how to get the coordination with the other nodes that are connected in the distributed network is also a challenging issue. So one best example of the distributed system or distributed computing is searching through Google. Whenever you search a query in the Google search, then the query related information will be fetched from different servers over the internet, and the final result will be presented to you as a search pages. So this is the way how the distributed computing or distributed networking will happen. When compared to the centralized and decentralized approaches, the main things in the main concepts that need to be considered in the distributed system are global clock. So there is no global clock in the distributed computing. And second one is any node or link failure. For example, if a node fails, then how other nodes come to know that this particular node is failed or a particular communication channel failed. So this is what a difficult task that need to be identified or to be focused in any distributed computing environment. And one more point that need to be considered in the distributed system is the concurrency. Concurrency means when two or more computers connected in the distributed computing, distributed network are doing a particular task, then how these devices will perform in synchronization, will perform the task in synchronization. This is what is called concurrency. So achieving concurrency is a difficult task in the distributed environment. A simple example is if a teacher is given assignment to you, then that assignment may consisting of 4 to 5 questions. And the teacher might have divided the entire class into some groups, and these groups have to work on the given assignment. And each group may consisting of 4 to 5 members. So there will be a group leader And this group leader will divide these tasks of the questions in the assignment among all the remaining members. And each and every member has to perform his given task. Now, while doing so, the particular task execution status need to be reported to the peer members, so that the peer members will also know that what other people are also doing. So accordingly, they will prepare the task, and finally one person will combine the task and will give the result back to the teacher. So this is the way how the assignment execution will be done by the students. In the same way, distributed computing will also be done in the similar way. When doing so, the concurrency, or that is the synchronization between the nodes, are here in the case of assignment example, synchronization between the students are important. At the same time, here while doing the task in the distributed network, the synchronization between the nodes are also equally important. So the important thing to be considered in the distributed computing is achieving concurrency, that is achieving an opinion or achieving synchronization in doing a particular task. Second one is how to know whether a node or communication link was failed. The third one is how to maintain the global clock. So these are the three aspects that we must consider in the distributed environment. So we have seen so far the structure of the three popular networking schemes or networking patterns. One is centralized, decentralized, second one is decentralized, and third one is distributed. So among these three, distributed is having the high fault tolerance, and the three concepts that we need to consider when going for the designing of the distributed network or use of the distributed networking are we have seen previously, that is clock and failure of node or link, communication link, and the concurrency concept. So designing the algorithms for these three is very, very difficult, and it achieves the high fault tolerance. Designing the algorithms for these three is a very difficult task. A lot of research has been done so far in the distributed computing, focusing on improving of the algorithms related to the clock, synchronization, and failure. This will help us sometimes in solving the problems such as how to overcome the centralized approach or how to overcome the monopoly of a particular organization, so that why can't we go for decentralized and peer-to-peer, so that we can avoid the domination of a particular central authority. So with this idea, these blockchain networks or blockchain applications have been designed. So in the blockchain applications, the main purpose is to avoid the central authority. So in among these three networks, which network don't have any central authority? So obviously the third one, the distributed network, don't have any central authority. But in case of decentralized approach, it has central authority. That is, if you consider these five nodes, obviously they are communicating with the central system here, and the central system in turn is connecting with the another server. But in case of distributed network, there is no central authority. Everyone is having their own configuration capability. It is a peer-to-peer, that is autonomous, and can communicate with the other nodes. So that is the reason in blockchain applications, distributed networking is used. And we can also say that most of the blockchain protocols will work on top of the internet and will work in a peer-to-peer fashion.